Welcome, Dr. G here, and in this video, we'll cover the fundamental concept of differential calculus, the derivative. Let's go. If you were to ask someone who's taken calculus or search up on Google what the term derivative means, you're most likely going to get an answer along the lines of instantaneous rate of change or instantaneous slope. While that's actually true, I find that could be misleading for students who are learning calculus because up until the moment they're learning the derivative, slope has a completely different meaning. The slope or rate of change is just the rise over run. But as you see in calculus, derivative isn't just rise over run.
The slope, also known as the rate of change, can be depicted as delta y over delta x, also known as the change in dependent variable over the change in your independent variable. But there are different types of slopes. Namely, there's the average slope and there's the instantaneous slope. For the average slope, we're looking to find the slope of a line that intersects two points on the graph, also known as the secant line. And the slope of that secant line will measure the average slope between the two points. On the other hand, for the instantaneous slope, we're trying to measure the slope of a line that touches only that point on a graph without intersecting the graph, also known as the tangent line. The slope of the tangent line will give us the instantaneous slope at that particular point on the graph. For a linear function, how do we find the slope? You might recall that we would need to know the two points, and we can find the rise and the run between the two points, taking the rise, dividing it over the run to give us a slope, in this case of 2. Alternatively, using the two points, we can also plug it into the slope equation, where m represents a slope here. By plugging the coordinates, you can see that we'll end up with the exact same slope as the rise over run method. This slope that we have, is this the average or instantaneous slope? Since we're using two points, we're actually finding the slope of the secant line between the two points. So this would be the average slope, which of course, in this case is 2. Notice the secant line looks identical to our actual linear function. What if I use two different points like this? If we plug this into the slope equation, you'll see that we get the exact same slope, which means the secant line between these two points also has a slope of 2, which makes sense because this secant line also looks identical to our linear function. So we can conclude that the slope of a linear function is actually the same as the slope of the secant lines. And that's because your secant lines in a linear function looks identical to the linear function. What if we want to find the slope at a particular point on this linear function, also known as the instantaneous slope? Well, in this case, we would need to draw a tangent line. But you might notice that's kind of weird because we can't really draw a tangent line for a linear function. We almost always draw tangent lines for functions that are curved. Nonetheless, you can see that our imaginary tangent line for this point looks pretty identical to the secant line again. If I were to stretch them both out, they completely overlap, which means that the slope of the tangent line is equal to the slope of the secant line, which is equal to the slope of our linear function. So for a linear function, not only is the slope of a secant line the same as the slope of the linear function, but so is the slope of any imaginable tangent lines that you can draw for any point. So for a linear function, let's say we have the equation of y equals 2x plus 1. In the form of y equals mx plus b, the m, which is a slope, in this case would be 2. That slope, now we know, represents both the average slope, which is the slope of the secant lines, as well as the instantaneous slope, which is the slope of the tangent lines.
Since calculus revolves around instantaneous changes and instantaneous slopes, for linear functions, we actually don't really need calculus to find the instantaneous rate of change, because the slope of a linear function is the instantaneous rate of change at any point in the function.
Now let's look at a higher order function like the quadratic function. How do we figure out the slope of quadratic functions? If I make a bunch of different points on a quadratic function and draw secant lines between them, you can see I can draw a bunch of different secant lines, none of which really give me any useful information. And if I take a look at each of these different points as if they're different points on a half pipe, you can see that the slope is different at each of these points. So what if I want to find the slope of a particular point on a quadratic function? In theory, I would have to draw a tangent line to that point, find the slope of the tangent line, because the slope of the tangent line would equal the slope at that particular point.
As you can imagine, drawing a tangent line by hand and finding out the slope is very difficult and probably not reliable. So there has to be a different way of us finding the slope of a tangent line without drawing a tangent line at all. And that's where calculus comes in.
In differential calculus, if we have the equation of our function, we can do something known as differentiation on that function to give us a new function, which is actually called the derivative. Let's take a look and see the differences between the original function f of x and the derivative f prime of x. If I know my x value is 1, let's say, and I plug that into my original function, it will give me the y-coordinate of that point. So by plugging in the x-coordinate into the original function f of x, we're always going to find the y-coordinate of that same point. Okay, what about the derivative? If I know that the x-coordinate is 1, and I plug that into my derivative, the value I get would be the slope of the tangent line at that point where my x is 1. Note that it doesn't actually give me the y-coordinate of that point. It just gives me the slope of the tangent line to that point, which is this instantaneous slope at that particular point.
So right now you're probably wondering, how did you find a derivative like that? Are you going to show me how to do that? I'm going to highlight the two different ways of differentiation, finding derivatives, later on in this video, but I'm going to go into the actual mathematics behind each of those methods in their own separate videos.
So as a rule, when we plug the x-coordinate into the derivative function, we're always going to find the slope at that particular point where x-coordinate is. So now we can define the derivative. The derivative is actually a function, f prime of x, that describes the slope of the original function. And if we know the x-coordinate, we can plug it in and it'll give us a slope of that particular point. So we can also think of it like a slope finder, only if you have the x-coordinate. Notice the word here we use to describe the derivative, a function. If the derivative is a function, that means it must be both graphable and represent a pattern. Let's take a look at the different points on a quadratic function again. We know that the slopes are different, and that can be shown here by drawing different tangent lines. But the slope is not just different, it's also changing in a pattern. And this pattern it's changing in can be graphed as the derivative function. So if this is the original quadratic function, then the derivative function we found can be graphed like this. Let's take a look and see how the derivative function graphically gives us the slope at all the different points on our original function. Let's take an x value of negative 2. If I trace up to my original function where the negative 2 is, I can see that the y value would be 4. This can be proved by plugging in negative 2 into the original function, and we end up with a value of 4. Not very surprising. Now let's trace downwards and see what happens when my x value is negative 2 on the derivative function. In this case, we can see that it hits a derivative function at negative 4. And that negative 4 is not the y value of my original function, it is the slope at that particular point on my original function. And again, this can be proved by plugging in negative 2 into my derivative, and we'll end up with negative 4, which is the slope at that point. Let's go back to our linear function. We already know that the instantaneous slope at any point is 2, and we did that without any calculus. But we can still do calculus on linear functions. We can still differentiate the linear function, and we'll get y prime equals 2. Not very surprising at all. If we were to graph this derivative, you can see it's a horizontal line where y equals 2, and that makes sense, because we said that the slope at any of these points is 2. And if you see where all these points intersect with our derivative function, it intersects where it's 2. To revisit the rule of derivatives, we said that the derivative is a function that describes the slope of the original function f of x. But for a linear function, we can also say that the derivative is the slope of that function. There's also a pattern with derivatives and their original functions. With these three original functions you see on the left, here are the derivatives on the right. Notice how the derivative is always 1 degree lower than the original function. So graphically, if my function is a linear function, that means my derivative is constant, which means that the slope at all the different points on my linear function is constant. It's the same. If my original function is quadratic, the slope is changing in a pattern that is linear. And if my original function is a cubic function, then my derivative function will be quadratic in nature. One interesting thing is, if your original function is constant, then your derivative will always be zero, because the slope of a flat horizontal line is zero. It doesn't really matter what the constant is. For example, my original function could be 3, or negative 2, or 1/2. The derivative for all of these functions are zero. So we've established that to find the derivative from the original function, we need to do something called differentiation. But how? Well, there's two different ways. The first way is using something called the definition of the derivative, which looks something like this. The second way, which you'll learn after learning the definition of the derivative, is to use the derivative rules, such as these ones you see here.
Like I said before, I will go over the definition of the derivative as well as derivative rules in their own separate videos, just because they're going to run a bit longer if I put them all into this video.
Now that we know about the derivative and how we get it through differentiation, The last thing to talk about is how we can actually represent the derivative. So for this equation here, y equals x squared, let's say that we know that if we differentiate it, we get the derivative of 2x. But what sign or what symbol do we use to represent the derivative? In other words, what derivative notation do we use? As you can see, there are many different derivative notations we can use that represents the same thing, which is the derivative. And if our function isn't y equals, but f of x equals, then we can also have a bunch of different derivative notations, as you can see here. To sum it up, here are the four different derivative notations we use. Primarily, you will see the ones on the left side here. One last note, we can actually differentiate further than just once, meaning we can find the derivative of a derivative. That will be called the second derivative. Or if you do it again, that will be called the third derivative. And we have notations for those as well. So keep in mind, these are the different derivative notations. Again, most of you will see Lagrange or Leibniz notation.
That is it for this video. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye.
If you like this video, consider subscribing to my YouTube channel and also follow me on my other social media platforms.